Welcome to Voices from the Bench, a dental laboratory podcast. Send us an email at info@voicesfromthebench.com or look for us on Facebook at Voices from the Bench. Greetings and welcome to episode 171 of Voices from the Bench. My name is Elvis.
And my name is Barbara.
What's happening, Barb? How are you?
I'm good. It's the Friday before the 4th of July that we are recording, so I'm super looking forward to a three-day weekend. Just sent my youngest off to Dayton, Ohio to spend a week up there with his buddy, so I am going to chill. Just saying.
Nice. No major plans? No fireworks in your future?
Nope, no fireworks, except for if you talk, well, no. Forget it.
Yeah.
You have to bleep me on that one.
Yeah, so Indianapolis didn't do fireworks last year, and I'm sure a lot of people didn't, but we're kind of excited to check it out again this year.
Oh, yeah. It's nice to be back to normal.
Yeah, it's a reason to get outside.
Yep. Other than running, of course.
Absolutely. So I just got back from my first multi-city travel with Preet. So I got to run into a bunch of different labs for the last 2 days. It was really exciting. Met a few fans of the podcast while I was out.
Oh, that's nice. That's nice to hear.
It always is. It kind of comes up awkward in a conversation, but it's always nice when it does. It makes me feel good. And then I feel like they know more about me than I know about them right off the bat. So,
and then you say, hey, would you like to be our next guest?
Yeah, that does come up. Hey, if you ever want to be on it, let us know.
Yeah.
And then bye from Preet. So you know what, Barbie? There's something we haven't talked a lot about this year that in previous years we talked a ton about.
Dun, dun, dun. I wonder what this is.
And that, of course, is the Race for the Future, which is at the seventh year running. So last year, COVID put it on hold, but it's back this year. If you haven't heard of the Race of the Future, it's a fundraising event that happens during the Chicago Triathlon. This year, the event is August 28th and 29th. So what it is a bunch of people from our industry participate in the triathlon, you know, swimming, biking, and running to raise money for the Foundation of Dental Laboratory Technology. Now, you can actually participate in the race yourself, or you can create a team and start raising money, or you can just donate to a specific racer and give back to the industry that has given you so much. Barbara's not doing it.
Well, what I'd like to say about that is that I'm a runner. Usually I do the whole thing. I decided this year that I'm way too busy, but I am a fast runner and I have a very fast swimmer. So if there's any of our listening that are really fast bikers or at least top mediocre bikers and want to team up and relay, hit us up at info@voicesfromthebench.com, please.
So basically you're saying you're not going to take the guy that comes with a huffy bike with a banana seat and...
I only do things to do them very well. So I'm not trying to be a jerk, but yeah, I need somebody that wants to freaking win.
Yeah, we need to get you going because this will be the seventh time in a row you've done this event.
And I've been training bad running. I've been running, and I'm ready. But can't find a biker. So no biker, no race for Barbara.
Well, let's see what we can find you one. So if anyone out there is into biking, Chicago area or not, let us know. We'll get a team going. And of course, Sean Nowak, who's always a top fundraiser, he's going to be doing it this year. So if you need to go and give money to anyone, let's give it to Sean. Not that he needs it.
Sean actually said he would swim on my team. So that's going to be tough because we always try to beat each other. But if I don't find a biker, I'm going to raise money for Sean too.
There you go. It all goes to a good cause. Yep. So we ask our listeners to go to dentallabfoundation.org. or the link found on this episode's show notes, and donate to the foundation. Even if all you can do is a dollar, it all goes to a great cause of education within the dental laboratory industry.
True to that.
This week, we got to talk to the talented Nina. I still don't even know if I said her last name right. Nina Frketin. Frketin.
I remember when she said Bleepetin.
Frketin. So this week, we got to talk to the talented Nina Frketin from the UK. Now, we love talking to technicians in other parts of the world because it brings a perspective that we don't always get to hear. Nina started her career at a young age in Croatia and eventually found a home at Dencraft Dental Lab in England. Falling in love with removables, but being able to do it all, Nina started a path of always striving to do better work and has recently been trying to perfect her work with composites. She does fantastic work that she posts on Instagram to show us all that we should all strive to be better. Join us as we chat with Nina Frketin. Whitmix is very excited to announce the new Pro 4K large format 3D printer from Asiga. The open material printer for the 385nm and the 405nm resins features renowned Asiga reliability and super fast print mode for large batch printing of virtually all print resins. It's ideal for printing any kind of model, denture, splint, surgical guide, impression trays, and more. As it does with other Asiga printers, the Pro 4K features the SPS Smart Positioning System technology, which ensures that the build platform is in the correct position when forming each layer, providing accuracy and continuity. The Asiga 4K DLP printer is affordable, so you can own it for under $25,000. It has a large build plate and is available in both the 65 micron and the 46 micron resolution versions. For more information about the Asiga Pro 4K, visit whitmix.com or call Chris Frye at 513-680-1512. And as always, we appreciate your support of the podcast, Whitmix. Voices from the Bench. The Interview.
It's always in a good spirit. It's never like...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. All right, let's get started. You ready?
Yeah, let's start.
We'd like to welcome to the podcast, I'm already going to butcher your last name, Nina Frketin.
Yeah, it's not so bad. Not so bad.
Oh, yeah, okay.
For Elvis, that's really good, just saying.
No, he did well. He did well. I heard it in much worse way pronounced, so well done, Elvis.
I appreciate that. And we're done. No. All the way from the UK, I think you might be our first international guest.
Yay!
I
mean,
we've talked to people from other countries, but not talked to them while they're in the other country, which is very exciting. And you're with Dencraft? Dencraft?
Dencraft. Yeah, Dencraft, without the T.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell us, Nina, how long have you been in the industry?
For too long.
Too long.
No, I started dental school when I was 14. So,
wow.
Yeah, it's been, I'll not tell you exactly how much, because then I will disclose
sure.
my real age.
But
it's been 20 plus years in this industry right now.
Is 14 common for an age for people to start dental technology?
Well, in our country, our school system is a bit different. So at 14, you can choose to learn to be a cook or dental technology or an electrician. Mm-hmm. So practically more manual skills. Or you can go to, well, we call it college for 4 years. But after that, you have to go to this university, practically. It's a bit different than in America.
And yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, I started my school at 14. It was a course 4 years full time. After that, we have to do a year of apprenticeship, unpaid, of course.
Of course.
After that, we have to pass the state exam. And just after that, we can become dental technicians. I can tell you, we are studying like we are gonna earn millions. All lies. All lies, deceit. Yeah.
How did you know at 14 that that's what you wanted to do? Or that's what you were interested in?
Well, I did not want to be a dental technician. I did not even know that this existed. So what I wanted to be was a children's book illustrator. That was, because I was drawing quite a lot and painting and stuff like that. So I had already my eye to the Academy of Fine Art in Venice. So that was where I wanted to go. But my parents, being a bit more traditional, they were like, ooh, No art. You have to take there a little bit of a more traditional upbringing. So my mom was like, you should go and see this dental technology. They are doing all these little bits and like waxing up and stuff. You should go and just check it out. So I was like, okay. So I went in the lab and for a week and I was hooked. I do think the dental technology is artistry. So I just fall in love and decided, yeah, that's my calling. And yeah, 20 years plus, I'm still here.
Which lab did you check out? Was it Dencraft?
No, it was so I'm Croatian. I'm half Croatian, half Italian. So I started my career in Croatia, and it was just a local lab that was in our city that took me in for this week to, you know, just like to see, to get the feel of if that would be something that I would like. So, yeah, I work actually in Croatia for some years. I work in Slovenia and then an opportunity came to move to the UK 10 years ago. So I took it and I moved to the UK and I'm still here. I'm still here. So it could not be so bad.
Yeah.
What are you doing in the lab right now?
As a dental technician in Croatia,
everything.
Exactly. We don't specialize in just one thing. We don't specialize just in prosthetics or in implant work. Or when you grow up and work in Croatia and smaller countries, more stuff you know, more valuable you are for the business.
Oh yeah.
Makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So I do everything. Yes, I do everything. I do. But my passion are dentures. Because nobody likes them so much. And to do a good denture, I think you have to have some kind of special, a little bit of skills there. Mm-hmm. So that's what I really like and enjoy doing. But I also do like hybrid gold crowns, practically everything that they give me, I'm happy to do.
But you mostly do removable. Did you fall in love with that while in school?
I don't mostly do removable. Mostly,
oh, really?
I do hybrid, so acrylic full arches, acrylic composite full arches. That's something that I do quite a lot. But the removable are, I don't know. It's just because like everybody always hated them. And I was just interested why, what's the reason why nobody likes them. And more I start to study and read about it and, you know, read about occlusion and read about the whole the way of setting teeth and stuff, I understood why nobody likes them. Because if you think about it, anything that it's cemented or screwed in the mouth will stay in the mouth. So it might chip the porcelain, it might chip the acrylic or the composite, but it will stay in the mouth. A bad denture will not stay in the mouth. So it takes a little bit of skill, not only of technical skill, but also from the clinician to take the right impression, to take the bites and stuff. So I just love it. I just love when a set of my dentures just work and the patient is happy and the clinician is happy and I'm happy. And I don't know, I just love it. And now with, now with composite and stuff, dentures look so much more natural. They are not just a piece of plastic. So, yeah, my artistry is like I got finally to the artistry, to be an artist, let's say.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mom and Dad, you should say. See?
Yeah.
Listen to your parents.
Yeah, they knew me better than what I knew myself, let's say, like this.
So, did they teach hybrid in school? I mean, that long ago, that wasn't really a thing. How did you pick it up?
No, they didn't teach. You get your basics in school and then you learn from different courses. And if you are lucky, you have good mentors. So I was lucky that when I worked in Slovenia, I actually worked in the lab that was part of an Ivoclar training center. So for those 2 years that I was working there, I went on so many courses, like everything that I possibly could go. I went. So I was lucky that I had lots of possibilities, you know, to learn from these courses. And then, of course, when I moved to England and when I started to work in my lab now, Dancraft, I was lucky to have great mentors here who taught me the basics. And then I wanted to improve my aesthetics. So I sit down myself and I just practice till I was not happy how it looks as well, you know, because I was happy with the functions, the function and everything. So I just wanted to improve my aesthetics. And that came just by staring at pictures of teeth, speaking to technicians that are smarter than me, and just by practicing, because I don't think that people can get to a certain level just by working 8 to 5. That's my theory. I might be controversial, but sometimes you have to put a couple of more hours to get to the level that you want to. And not saying, you know, I don't absolutely think I want to be even better than what I'm now. I don't think I yet reach that level that I want to be, but I'm getting there. I'm pushing, I'm trying hard. So hopefully, you know, I'll get there.
Yeah. I don't think most technicians, I don't think they ever get there. They're always looking for improvement.
Oh, heck yeah. You always see something. Ditto. Agree.
I'm very self-critical of myself and of my work to the point that sometimes, like, I have to stop myself and say, Nina, just be kinder to yourself, because sometimes I can be too hard on myself. And I think some technicians can definitely do, you know, I speak a lot with other technicians recently, especially in this last year and stuff through Instagram and stuff. And everybody has this kind of imposter syndrome, feeling like that they're not good enough. And it's just like, in one way, it's nice to know that you are not alone. But in another way, I'm thinking like, oh, you know what? We should be a bit kinder to ourselves, because we are sometimes a little bit too harsh.
Yeah.
You must be born in September.
Me? No, I'm born in March. 1st of March.
I'm surrounded by a bunch of September technicians, and we are all very, very similar and very analytical and very hard on ourselves. So I hear you.
Yeah, but it is a bit of a, you know, I have some days and stuff where I really feel down and I look at some things that I produce and I'm like, and everybody's telling me it's beautiful. What are you on about? It's perfect. It's, you know, even my clinicians say to me, you know, the patient was so happy. And I'm like looking at the picture and I'm thinking, oh, I could have put a little bit of more of this here or there. It's just like, I don't know. I think we should all be learn to be a little bit more kinder to ourselves and a bit going easy, because in the end we are doing the best we can. And of course, some days we have days off. We are all people.
So I'm wondering, after going through all of that, at your laboratory in the UK, do you have any digital? And if so, are you looking at digital dentures at all and any of the designs?
I have my theories on digital. So I don't think it's, for me personally, I saw the dentures, it is the future. It's really interesting. I love the theory and I love everything behind it. But for me personally, for our kind of clientele and from what we think here, it's a nice smile. They are not there yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. We hear that a lot.
Yeah, look what, I mean, also to me, I'm a little bit, because everybody's saying about digital denture, they fit beautifully, they this and that. The people forget that they will fit beautifully, they will function beautifully if you can take a good impression, if you can take a good bite, if you can, the same thing. So it's not a solution for everything. If you are incapable of doing a good traditional impression or a good traditional bite, there is a possibility that even digital denture will not be a solution for you. That's what I
agree. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and I think even like technicians and stuff, if you don't know the rules and if you don't know how to set up the teeth to have a stable occlusion and function and stuff, you will struggle again, even in digital. So I know that there is a big faff and there is a big boom about digital, and I think it will get there. But I think we need to also teach, you know, our technicians and our clinicians first of how to do them properly, and then we're going to see. But I mean, Elvis, you follow me on my Instagram and stuff.
Yeah.
Do you think that digital will ever manage to produce what I can produce by hand?
Not straight out of a printer, not straight out of a mill. I mean, I think we'll get to the point where with a lot of hand work after, but you do beautiful stuff on Instagram, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah, I know you're critical of yourself, but it's fantastic stuff.
Oh, thank you so much.
When did you start posting everything on Instagram?
So I started my Instagram around 4 years ago, but it was not really something, I'm not really a social media addict.
Yeah.
I wasn't. I am now a little bit. I started to post on Instagram around 4 years ago, but it was very sporadic and it was not like something that I used to go there or I, you know, there would be months that I did not open my Instagram. But in this last year, because of lockdown, and here in England, we had quite strict rules about movements and stuff. So we spend lots of our time at home. On our phones. So in the last year, I decided, you know, I had a little bit of more time. I was feeling a bit lonely and isolated, like lots of people did. So I decided, okay, let's, you know, let's start a little bit more seriously with this Instagram. So I started to post a little bit more things. And, you know, I met fantastic technicians. I mean, I'm so happy that I've not been so lazy, that I stopped being lazy. And because I met fantastic technicians from all around the world and especially like United States. And it's just like such a great community, you know, and we support each other. And just knowing that we have the same, I don't know, fears or the same problems or some, you know, it's just like a community that supports you in those moments when you think, oh, you know what, I'm tired of this job. I just want to give up. I do enjoy it quite a lot.
For those that don't know, I mean, I'm relatively new to Instagram. Someone recommended about a year and a half ago that the podcast should be on it. And I'm like, okay, let's check it out. There is a huge community of dental technicians all around the world. Lots of removable, beautiful stuff. I was amazed how large the community of dental technicians was on Instagram. It's really nice. I recommend anyone in our industry to go check it out. Just join.
I'm actually on Instagram right now looking for you, Nina. Where do I go and how do I find you?
I don't know, neither do I.
Is it your last name, Nina?
It's Nina _F _DT.
Okay, gotcha.
I think I should be there.
Yeah, wait till you see this stuff. It almost looks like people's teeth were taken out of their mouth.
Well, that's the idea. I think that, like, you know, this composite and stuff, this would be such a big game in this digital denture industry. Because, like, you can transform something that looks a little bit more, let's say, simple. To me, you know, every country has a different idea what a perfect smile should be, and that's fine. But for me, I like a bit more natural. I know that USA, it's a bit more different than than Europe, but like, I think that if you use composite to, let's say, pimp it up, pimp up the dentures, they should be, they should be looking like pretty neat. You know, maybe something like, that's the how to go forward.
It looks like you twist your laterals a little bit and change the axis on your laterals, which is gorgeous.
Yeah.
And of course, I'm looking at it.
Is that your signature, twisting the laterals?
That's the my signature move. Generally, because I try to, of course, some patient wants straight white and that's fine. You know, if they want something like that, of course, I will. In the end, is what the patient want and what they think it's beautiful. But if I don't have any instructions, like, you know, how do they want the teeth setting or any pictures, then I will always try to sneak just a tiny bit of imperfections in the setup, just because I think if you're a 70-year-old or an 80-year-old, and if you have straight white teeth, everybody will know that something there is not right, is it? But if you have a little bit of irregularity, then, you know, they might not be so visible.
And it adds personality. I love it. It's beautiful.
Absolutely.
That's what I was always told. I'm a ceramist by skill. And, you know, if you tweak the laterals or, you know, you give it a mesial tilt, that it gives it more personality. And I completely agree. Beautiful.
Thank you.
How is it set up at DenCraft? Do you get to see the patient? Is there a lot of communication or?
A lot of communication. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we are very lucky because we are at the top of a practice. So underneath, we are at the top of a practice and we work for around 9 different dentists in the same building. Some days it's like a revolving door in and out of the lab all the time. But you can learn so much because, of course, the dentist calls you downstairs. You can see the patient. You can see your drawings. Let's say for my composite, that's perfect because I can shade match them. Mm. I go and take pictures for shades, for ceramic, for pink, for everything. And, you know, if you do also something wrong, they bring you down and then tell you, you know, this is... you should be doing this like this. So you actually can see what you did wrong. And it helps you learn so much faster, you know, when you have actually a patient there in front of you and you can see your mistakes or you can see what did you do right. So, yeah, we are lucky. But of course, we work also for external clients and the ones that are not in the building. It's just a huge amount of pictures. Skype, communication, discussions. And this practice here that we work for, it's a referral practice. So we get lots of really difficult cases for implant cases. So it's a case will never be straightforward. It will never be like a nice, easy all on four. It would always be something difficult. But the challenge is what I think all technicians here feel the same as I am. These challenges is what keep you interested in the work. And what push you to be better and to improve yourself.
Yeah, it'd be boring to do the exact same case over and over and over.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I like how she said it all on four. A nice, simple, easy all on four. I caught that.
It's not, unfortunately. It's not like, it's never a straightforward case. It's always something that, I don't know, a patient is suing a dentist and then they refer the patient here. So you already know something is wrong with everything from the planning to the execution of the case. So you already have a patient that it's riled up, of course. And you have to come down like as the last, wheel because technicians, unfortunately, and they're all crying or already upset and unhappy with their smile. And you are a little bit also like a psychologist, not only a dental technician, but it's all fun. It's all fun and games. It's all part of our job. And, you know, in the end, if I'm still here 20 years after, I love it, obviously. Something must have kept me here. The money, it's not it, so must be love.
So these patients come from a previous doctor and they have like misplaced implants, enough vertical clearance, that kind of, wow.
Yeah, it's a referral practice. Yeah. So practically every case that if some implant cases go wrong or something happen or some stuff like that, we get it here. So it's a little bit, that's why we have lots of discussions and lots of talk about every case that comes in the lab. It's never like, just sit down and let's do it. It's very rare that it's like that. It's almost always like, oh, this will not work. This will not work. You then spend hours trying to contact somebody to get the right stuff to do the job. It's not easy. It's not easy.
Do you get a lot of implants that you don't recognize that you've never worked with?
Sometimes, more or less, we all. Yeah. I don't know how. What are your implants in America? What do you use the most?
Oh, geez. What would you say, Barb?
The big variety.
The bigger, you know, Straumann, Nobel, Zimmer, BioHorizon.
Yeah.
These are more or less. Our big two are Straumann and Astra. That's what we use here mainly. But
Astra,
of course, we have Megagen, we have Neodent, we have lots of different varieties. Not always the one that we don't recognize, but sometimes, of course, some of them come, a copy of something. And that's also like,
absolutely.
And most of the time the patient have no idea what implant is it or cannot contact the dentist.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we all know how that goes. And then you spend the days trying to find the bits and bobs to manage to make it work.
Yep.
But it is what it is.
Yeah, I had a text the other day. Placed 15 years ago in Brazil. What is this?
Oh, yeah.
What? I don't even know what they place in Brazil now.
Oh, I can totally understand.
But that's half the fun of the job, you know? That's half the fun, trying to figure it out, and the mystery and the puzzle. It's I enjoy it.
Sometimes it is, but sometimes when you see your hair getting like a receding line.
Yeah. Yes.
Because of the stress of trying to find all this stuff. But yeah, it's it is part of the job. So if you like it or hate it, you have to deal with it. And that's it.
That's true.
So in England, do you guys do a lot of zirconia cases, or is it mostly, you said you did gold. Is it still a fair amount of gold?
So it's not like, I think in America, I mean, it's a lot of zirconia, full arch zirconia, what I see from technicians doing. Here in England, but that's because your surgeons don't mind chopping off half of the bone of the mouth. Here, it's all about conservation. So very rarely people will go and do a full surgery and take off lots of bone and stuff. So mainly our structures are still metal-based. So you would have as I told you, or acrylic or porcelain or composite or Toronto bridges, like more metal-based structures. I mean, I would love that they just go crazy, take away a little bit of, this bone so I can do this beautiful, also zirconia arches with beautiful pink, but unfortunately, no, I don't get that. Mine are always very limited with space and always high aesthetic. That's always what I get. Very limited with space and high aesthetic. And then I don't sleep for 2 days thinking I'm going to do it.
What I like hearing about is like the differences between, the UK and the United States. And when you had mentioned gold, I was thinking, wow, instead of saying zirconia, you mentioned gold. So I was thinking that, that's probably the direction that your laboratory is at. So it's pretty remarkable. And I completely agree. We get some crowns that they just prep the hell out of and just, so it's good. Good to know.
We do zirconia more in the last couple of 3-4 years, like, bridges or single crowns and stuff like this. So we do, because I also stay in zirconia. So we have quite a few people going down that route because, of course, people don't want really, metal shining through the gum anymore and stuff. When you have a little bit of recession, you always get those problems. Yeah. So, people, and plus, zirconia looks nice. It's not so expensive. we have more, but not unfortunately full arches. I mean, I would love to do it, but I don't know. At least our clients here don't do them. I don't know, maybe somewhere else in the UK they do, but I'm in quite a few forums and stuff and I never noticed talking about zirconia full arches. So yeah, I think
we don't do a lot here either. Can you imagine how heavy that is for a patient? Oh my God. Ugh, just the thought of it.
Go ahead.
Let's say.
Go. Go.
Let's say, like, if we do composite, or if I do the hybrid between acrylic and composite, my metal bar will always be in titanium. So the whole thing, it will be super light. Like, it's so light compared to some, let's say, porcelain arches that are so heavy. I always used to joke when I get, like, a porcelain arch or something that it's massive. I'm always like, oh, I hope this patient does not go to swim because they're going to swim with the fishes. He's going to sink.
Neck trouble. What do you usually do when you get that full arch that has limited vertical space? What's your go-to? There's only so much you can do.
Well, yes. Yeah, well, we try to teach all our new dentists, the one that we have on board and stuff, that planning is number one.
Yeah.
Let's plan it properly. We generally always do or PMMA trines, or we do some kind of tooth trine or something. So I always more or less, you know, we plan with the spaces.
Yeah, so you open that vertical to get what you need.
If I have to, yes. If I have to.
Yeah.
But we tend always to get that minimum amount of space that we need to make it look decent. Sometimes you cannot make it look wow, because of course you don't have a massive amount of space. So you know, you're a bit limited. But like, we always try to make it look decent, because of course some patient you can open 5 millimeters and they will be fine. Some patient you can open a millimeter and a half and they will immediately have TMJ's problems or something else. So you have to be like really careful.
Yeah,
really careful how you are playing with the openings and stuff. But that's why we do temporaries and stuff. And you know, sometimes our patient, like everybody, keeps wearing temporaries and open OVD to see if they will tolerate it and stuff. So there is ways, but it's not something straightforward. It's again into the planning, and every dentist that we work with, they are on board with our way, you know, our protocol of doing things, because it's bulletproof. They know that at the end, what they will get, the patient will be happy, they will be happy, and in the end, and they will not have problems. So even if it takes a bit longer, you know, a bit of a longer road to get there, sometimes it's better.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Agree. It's always better.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you design the bars or do you guys send those out?
So what we do, we use Atlantis or Cryotech for our... Yeah, so what we do, we would have a trine and stuff, scan it in, send the scan of the trine to Atlantis or whoever we are choosing to use in that moment. Mm-hmm. And they will send back the design of the bar. One of us check it over to make sure that everything is fine. And then we approve it or we ask for changes depending on how it's going.
Is that made there in the UK or is it Atlantis? Does it come here to America?
No. Atlantis is in... Rob, where is Atlantis? In Belgium.
Oh, really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the superstructures are in Belgium, while the abutments and stuff is made in Sweden.
Mm.
So it's all in Europe, practically. Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Rob just got a cameo.
Rob is my manager. He is here. Like, if I forgot some English words, he will be like, Nina, help. I will like, Rob. Sometimes, you know, my English still eludes me, especially when I'm tired and then I forget words. So Rob helps me sometimes in expressing myself.
I work with somebody from Bosnia that came over to the U.S. And sometimes I'm like, I can't understand you today. You're talking Bosnian. And it's our English and it just cracks me up. So I'm pretty used to it. You're doing a great job.
Oh, thank you. Sometimes Rob is very good with charades, because some days I'm like, Rob, give me the thing for the thing. And he knows what I mean. After 10 years of working with me, he knows. So it's like, I always tell him he's like a brother I never wanted, but I got.
It's a good thing to call your manager.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what kind of composite do you use?
Oh, well, I use variation of different composites. So depending.
Okay.
I tried quite a lot of them. I'm a total composite snob, like hardcore.
I love that.
Yeah. Some people have, I am a composite snob. So I tried quite a few of them. And recently, I just started to use Anaxdent from...
Because, great stuff. Yeah.
Well, because one of my American friends, he was like, you know, you have to try Anaxdent. And I'm like, okay, let's try this Anaxdent. But I'm like, you know, I'm ready. I'll tell you if I don't like it. And
yeah,
I loved it. So it's so it's now in my I mainly use Anaxdent for all my hybrids now, and for my denture work I use Nexco from Ivoclar. So I have this
Ivoclar,
so these two are my most favorite ones, and they are the ones that I use all the time, and I'm just happy I tried Anaxdent. So Yay for Annex then.
When you say you'll tell them if you don't like it, so what are the positives of a composite that you really like? Like, what are the differences? I don't do composites, so that's a, it may sound like a stupid question, but I'm curious. So what makes it great?
Yeah, it's not a stupid question. I think everybody is different. So everybody will search for some specific stuff. For me, if it's that it's easy to manipulate. So it's not like sliding around or something, but if I put it somewhere, it stays. Colors are very important. Like, I tried quite a few. These are one of the most important things, the colors. I tried quite a few, and I just don't like the shades. They are too orange or just not natural. So with Anaxdent and Nexco, the shades are just beautiful. Like, especially with Anaxdent, you are bulletproof. You cannot do a mistake because the shades are just so great. And Anexco is great because it's a little bit more transparent. So it has a bit of transparency. While Anaxdent has a bit of opacity. So it's great for hybrids and stuff, you know, when you try to cover up metal and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
For me, it's just that I can be quick with it. So, you know, some composite, you try to put them on and they're just sliding around. They're like little snakes going all the way around. Well, this one, I just take my piece, I stuck it up and it stays there. Perfect, color does not change. And makes it's just sense. Like, yeah, it's lovely. And it's lovely to polish as well and stuff. I mean, some people don't polish composite. Some people used to put some glazes over it. Some people polish them. It depends on the job. But when I polish my composite, I also do not want to spend hours trying to polish it. I just want to sit down, do it, and, you know, so that it looks awesome. Mm-hmm. And both of these composites I'm quite happy with. So, yeah, those are my two favorites.
Can you intermix them? Can you use, like, the incisal of one in the body of another?
Every person will tell you different, you know, especially every company will tell you, no, don't do that. I mix and match. I have also some composites from Breeden, some composites from Shotlander, some composites, there are lots of types of it. And sometimes on some cases, not on every case, but on some cases, yeah, I mix and match because this one has a little bit more lighter pink or, you know, less opacity and stuff. So I definitely mix and match.
Nice. And they're all light cured, right?
Yeah. As long as you treat, as long as you treat it properly, they will work. Mm-hmm. They're all light cure. So as long as you treat your timings right, as long as you treat like your base coat and stuff right, everything will be fine, even if you mix and match.
Cool. Thank you.
Interesting.
Yeah, because I worked with composite for the last 5 years and I never had a delamination, not once. I think that says something.
Oh, yeah.
That says something.
I'll say.
In the UK, don't they have economy dentures? Or is it like here in America where you have those places you can go to get a lesser cost denture?
Oh, yeah.
Does everybody make them like you?
No, but I make also simple dentures, like not like it's not economy, but just like, let's say, Ivo-based material. So they are still a high standard denture with high standard materials. They don't just have the, let's say, the bells and whistles that some of the dentures have. So I do still do normal traditional acrylic work. There are some places, of course, not our lab because we do only private high-end work. Yeah. But there are some places, of course, that you can get like cheaper dentures for cheaper value with cheaper teeth. They are generally one-man bands. That's how we call them, one-man lab, no? One-man band.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you can. But then again, I don't know, for me, I might be a bit of a snob in teeth as well, because like for me, teeth are something that you wear all your life.
Yeah.
It's something you eat with, it's something you sleep with, it's something that impacts your health. And I think that people should pay a bit more to get something amazing And, you know, I know that not everybody can afford it. I can totally understand. But if you have the possibility, I think that, you know, you should splurge out on your teeth, because that's something that you wear every day. And in the end, it's, you know, presenting you to the world, let's say, like that.
Do you have a hard time doing those dentures when you have so much passion for the bells and whistles, as you said?
No, because 5 years, like, you know, I did not know that these composites and stuff existed till 5 years ago. And for me, doing traditional dentures, I'm passionate about any kind of denture. I'm like, it's just because for me, it's more about the occlusion, you know, especially when I get like some ridges that are like wildly flat and stuff, and I have to choose which scheme to go with and stuff. To me, it's just like a competition against myself. It does not matter. It does not have to be. Of course, I love the bells and whistles and I like my little artistry and stuff. But I think I just like to make people smile. And I want to, it does not matter if it's a cheap denture or an expensive denture. I just want that person feel confident. They can eat, they can smile, and, you know, just can be a happy person. So to me, it does not matter what kind of denture I'm making or what kind of bridge.
That's great.
Well said. I agree.
Have you ever participated in the Panthera Cup?
Ha!
Wow. Where the hell did you pull that question?
Have you heard of it?
So I heard of it because of my American friend told me that we should participate together and to see who wins.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, damn.
That was a couple of... Oh, I love a challenge. Oh, I'm a sucker for a challenge. And that was a couple of years ago. Unfortunately, he cannot because he's very busy. So I bite at it and I decided to participate this year.
Wow.
Well, that is a really good story, actually, because I did not know what is it exactly, what's going to happen and stuff. So I went to the podcast to listen. Jeff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I listened to the podcast and I listened what they were talking and you and stuff. And I was like, oh, okay, I have to do this and I have to do this. And then a couple of days after, I was like, okay, I need to write him. I need to ask him, I need to ask him this question. But I was like a little bit uncertain how to approach him on Instagram, you know, like a weird girl asking his help. But weirdly enough, I posted a picture of one of my jobs and he contacted me. He sent me a message telling me, Nina, did you ever think of participating to the Master Cup? And I would like to nominate you.
Oh, nice.
And he said to me that he took inspiration from my composite work for his submission for his work.
For his competition?
Yes, for the Panthera Master Cup.
Wow.
So he took inspiration. I mean, he came, I think second or third he came from the Show Lab group.
Yeah, second or third.
And so practically he wrote me that he took inspiration from my composite and he wants to nominate me to compete in the Panthera Master Cup.
Awesome.
So I was like, what? Here I am thinking I'm not good enough. And the guy that was one of the three best technicians in this like competition is telling me he got inspired by my pictures. I was so happy.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was very, very good.
That's a huge compliment, too.
Yeah, it was. It was. Because sometimes, as I told you, I can be really hard on myself as lots of technicians. And I think, you know, it's hard to see. I don't know why we can see greatness in others, but we cannot see greatness in ourselves sometimes. So that was like, it made my day, my month, my week. I was so happy. I was super happy.
That's great. So when does the competition start? Has it started this year?
I know that he'd submitted my name. And before that, I also submitted my name because I did not expect that he will say this. Did not get no email yet, nothing. So I'm not sure that it started yet. But I'm waiting now. I'm waiting to see what will happen.
That's exciting. I'd love to hear about your journey. Watch it on Instagram because I bet it's going to be awesome.
Where is it at?
It's out of Panthera. So it's out of K Canada.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and every year they have people from all over the world, and they all get the same case in the same type of bar. Mm-hmm. And then they have this huge competition. And Beatrice over there at Panthera, she kind of heads up the thing, and it's cool. Every year, Mark Williamson won it 1 year. A bunch of people. It's really neat.
Well, I remember we talked about it, but I just couldn't remember where exactly it was. So you're yeah. travel there, or you can you do it virtually, or how does that work?
No, practically what they do is they send you. So first you have to submit. It's not like that you go straight to the competition. You first yeah. have to submit a case that you did mm-hmm. and stuff and do a little bit of a writing thing. That's what I understood. And then they choose from all the submission the 10 best ones. And then these 10 best ones get sent the case that they choose, the different bar or whatever, so mm-hmm. to the technician. And then you have a specific amount of time. I think it's quite long, actually, where you do the where you do this job, and you have to document like why you choose this teeth, why you did this and stuff, practically. And then you send it back to them. And I think that before COVID, they used to fly the contestant to Canada, I'm pretty sure, like to see to the like yeah. big reveal who is the three winners. But of mm-hmm. course, now from when COVID hits, I don't think it will be possible this year still. I'm not sure how your rules are still, but here in England, we are still a bit weird on international travels. So I'm not sure it will be possible to be flying. So it will be probably a virtual thing, like to see who won. And
nice.
Usually they let the winner speak at their booth at the IDS.
Oh, that's wow. really good.
Yeah.
Okay, so here I am. Where is next IDS? I have to start to prepare my speech.
I love the confidence.
I am a very modest person.
You just got to remember to thank the podcast.
Yes, yes. But you have to have it with intention. You have to go in this kind of stuff with intention of winning. I think I fail miserably, but at least it will be such an amazing experience. So, I plan to win it. That's how I go into this.
There you go.
That's how I go into this. Oh, maybe I will flop and, next time you can joke with me and say, hey, Nina, did you win that Pantera? No, shut up, Elvis, don't mention it anymore.
We're not talking about it.
Yeah.
So, Nina, what's next for you and Dentcraft? Do you still get to do a lot of continuing education with them?
Yes, well, what I hope my next stage will be, I would love to teach.
Oh,
so
nice.
I would love to get into that a little bit more, like to do some courses with composites and stuff like that, because that's my big passion. And it seems that lots of technicians are really getting into that. And, mm-hmm. For me, when I started the composites and stuff, I did not have so much of support, from the technician mm-hmm. that I used to ask questions and stuff, because I was a little technician and nobody wanted, how they swat you off like a little fly. They don't want to lose time with you. So, I would like to teach. I would like to help technicians better themselves and, reach their next level, because I think there are lots of, technicians out there that do want to improve and stuff. And maybe they're a little bit, don't know where to go or don't know who to turn to. So, yeah, that's something I would like to do.
Nice.
Awesome.
You ought to come to Chicago Lab Day and teach for Annextent.
Well, Fro, you said it. I mean, whoever is listening to this podcast, I think Elvis is so smart and he gives some great ideas. I mean, I would absolutely, absolutely love to do that. That's why, that's my secret dream. That's my secret dream. I would love to go anyway, come to Chicago. And at some point I will definitely do, because I met so many amazing technicians in America that I just have to meet in person, that I just have to sit down and have a beer with these people and just have a chat eye to eye, because last year was hard for everybody and they made it so much easier just by, having this little community and talking to each other and just complaining about, work, about everything. It was just like, I just have to meet them. So hopefully,
yeah,
I will. There will be the time that I come and, you know, I have a beer also with you too. Because why not?
Why not? Yeah, that the online community for dental technicians really grew over the pandemic, and it was nice to see so many people connect.
Yeah, absolutely. Also here, you know, in England and stuff, you know, you meet people on your courses and stuff, but that's about it. Then you don't see each other anymore, and that's it. Well, on this pandemic and stuff, I met so many other dental technicians also here from England, and that I would never have probably the opportunity to meet. And we are really, sure. You know, I had a really difficult case this week, and I was not sure what to do. So I called my, I met this technician. He is from Scotland. So I called him like through Instagram, and I was like, can I call you? Because I know that he does a lot of these kind of cases while I don't. So I was like, mm-hmm. Oh, can I give you please a ring on Instagram and you can help me just step by step? Because of course, you know, I am an experienced technician. Yes. But do I know everything? No, there is always room for improvement. And he answered my call and he helped me out, and the job turned out beautiful. And, you know, it's just that you can have somebody on the other side of the phone to ring if there is a problem or something. While before, you had to sit down and just like spend days on the internet trying to search the solution.
Yeah. Yeah. If someone didn't make a video about it, you're out of luck.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. If that is not on YouTube, we are not going to make it. If it's not on YouTube.
That's hilarious. All the way to Scotland, huh? That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Nina, we appreciate you coming on the podcast. That's some cool stuff. Mm-hmm. I love seeing what you're doing on Instagram. I encourage everyone to go check it out and see this amazing composite that you do.
It's thank you. You get me all red or blushed.
I already did, and I echo it. It's absolutely stunning. Beautiful work.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Like if that kind of work was in our lab, I wouldn't even know what to do with it. It's so out of our league, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's almost too good for America.
Oh my God. That's a little bit of a big compliment, but thank you. Thank you. I don't think it is. I think it's, as I told you before, it's just like different countries have different ideas what a perfect smile is, you know. We like a little bit more natural, a little bit more crooked, while your patients, they like a little bit, you know, straight and a little bit more on the whiter side.
Yeah, bright white.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah. But, you know, if you look at technicians in Brazil or if you look at technicians in Australia, everybody has a different smile or concept what a perfect smile is. And that's what makes us unique. If we are all the same, then what's the point, is it?
Yeah.
There's Elvis's dogs. There's
my dog.
They're wishing you good luck.
Thank you, doggo.
Something's got her riled up. Well, Nina, thank you so much. We appreciate you coming on the podcast.
Oh, thank you so much, guys, for having me. I really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, hopefully we'll see you in Chicago sometime.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Yes, hopefully. On the Annex Dent boot.
I'll give Tay a call right when we're done.
Oh, so my God. She is amazing. Like, bless her. I speak to them as well. Like, they're a cool bunch of people. But all of them. So.
Great bunch. Awesome. We'll talk to you later.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Right. So thank you so much for coming on our podcast, Nina. It was super great to talk to technician, especially from overseas, learn about what is different and similar with our industry. Nina does fantastic work, and you will be a better technician if you head over to Instagram and look her up. If you missed it, type in NINA_F_DT and give her a follow. Beautiful stuff. We wish the best to you in the Pantera Master Cup. We know that you're going to crush it. We can have you back on when you win, so good luck. But everyone will get a chance to see more from her when she makes her dream come true and does a hands-on course at Lab Chicago. Right, Tay? We know we have many listeners in many different countries, and we want to hear from you. So again, reach out to us at info@voicesfromthebench.com. We can set up a time for you to be on the podcast and tell us about all the amazing things that you are doing in your country.
And we know for a fact, because Elvis takes stats on this, that we have lots of listeners out there from other countries. So hit us up.
So we are just 3 weeks away from Ladies of the Mill Summit. This amazing event is happening in Chattanooga, Tennessee on July 23rd and 24th. Voices from the Bench will be at the Preet booth recording all the amazing attendees, speakers, and maybe some of the sponsors. Heck, anyone we can get to sit down at the booth. Male or female, head over to ladiesofthemill.com to register, and we will see you there.
Nice.
All right, everybody. That's all we got for you. We'll talk to you next week.
Bye.
Bye. That was depressing. Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
All right, you ready?
Yeah, ready. Are you ready, buddy? All right.